Welcome to Breadboarding. This is a summary video of the first 12 videos in the Breadboard PC series. The Breadboarding Labs channel I started around August 2022, building reliable digital electronics projects on good quality breadboards at frequencies probably higher than most professional advice would advise. And I started with the Nanocomp 6809 project. This is a picture of the end of the project. The video controller on the left-hand side needs some tidying up. But basically this built out an initial CPU, clock and buffers, adding ROM and address decoding and RAM. Then we added a serial port and peripheral interface adapter to control the keypad, 7-second keypad. We needed to upgrade the power at some point. Then most of the project was around adding a VGA compatible video controller, which is able to do both character based 16 color, where we developed a Tetris game, 2 color high res graphics, where we developed a Lunar Lander game, and in the end, the high color 256 color mode, where we then displayed the Doom startup image. Then we added a PS2 keyboard, sound and joystick, and then finally an IDE hard disk and hard disk controller. Now, if you want to see this series, there'll be a link at the top of the screen at the moment and also the description below. Now, the IBM PC was released around October 1981. It used the Intel 8088 version of the 8086 processor. This had an 8-bit data bus versus a 16-bit data bus for the 8086. There are a few breadboard 8088, 86 projects out there, but I don't believe there's any building PC compatible project. So the PC is going to hopefully run an early version of MS-DOS. Video will be a monochrome display adapter. We're going to use architectural components from the 1981 PC, PCXT, PC80, PS2, and the Compact Despro 386. Before we add the Intel 8088 microprocessor, the first thing we need to do is to add the power supervisor and reset circuit. What this does is ensures that the microprocessor only comes out of reset when the power is stable after switch on. It will also monitor the voltage levels and reset CPU if they go out of tolerance. It can also debounce the reset switch and also has a watchdog circuit that will reset the CPU if it detects that the CPU is hung. Now, we won't be showing any of the logic analyzer signals here. You'll sometimes see the logic analyzer probe being plugged in, which we use for the testing in the full videos. If you want to see the logic analyzer use, please go to the playlist and watch the whole series. Breadboard buddy for the power rails in. So just plugging in the reset switch that goes to ground at the top there and then will be fed into the button reset. We're just wiring up our LED, the first of 1,000 components, make sure that works. Yep, so as per 8088 book, we just plugged in the supervisor circuit, wire in the power, check the schematic to see what we need to connect. So the tolerance is going to 5 volts, which means that it will be 10%. We need to put in the push button, then we're going to wire in the pull-up resistor for the reset line, wire in the LED, and then put in the power. So that seems to be working. Now we're just going to wire in the logic analyzer lead so that we can actually check it in a minute. So the LED flashes when the CPU is running. The flashing is caused by the watchdog timer because there's no strobe at the moment. When we put the voltage down, then it was in reset. Now we're just going to put a strobe signal and then press the reset. So now we've got the power supervisor and reset circuit working. We now need to add the 14 megahertz clock and the Intel 8284 clock controller circuit. What this does is generates all the clock signals necessary for the peripherals and for the microprocessor itself. The 8088 requires a 33.66% duty cycle for it to operate correctly. Okay, so just plug in the power rails, then the decoupling capacitor. Just need to tie that one up to the ground rail there. Do some of the other tying to ground. Actually put those in on the wrong pins when I looked at it from on top. So the other tying to ground, put in the resistor for the crystal. Then we just need to move those down and put in the crystal. Then we're just going to plug in the rest of the logic analyzer signals. Now we need to wire in the reset signal down into the clock, and we also need to put the watchdog strobe. So now we've got the power supervisor, reset and clock circuit working. We're going to install the microprocessor. And initially, because this has an 8-bit data bus and a 20-bit address bus, it needs to multiplex some of these signals over the shared lines. And what we're going to do initially was going to wire up the data bus to the no operation instruction. And this is 90 hexadecimal. What this will do is just make the microprocessor cycle through the address bus so we can just check to see that the signals are working. We use the logic analyzer to test this, but we won't be showing that output in part of this video. So just going to replace the jump wires with fitted wires and position the CPU. Okay, so just checking all the pull-up resistor values that we need to put in there. So those are the power rails. The min-max is low, so that's max mode. So these are some of the pull-up resistors for some of the bus control signals and test. And we put in the two interrupts so that those don't cause any trouble. Then we're going to wire in all of the data lines to the 5-volt line and ground for the 100100, that's 90 hex. Then we're going to need to put the two in there to make sure the ready signal from the clock circuit there comes down. Wire in ready, reset, and the clock. So now we know that the microprocessor is cycling through the address lines using the no operation free run mode. What we're going to do now is to address the multiplexed bus. In order to do this, we need to add an Intel 8288 bus controller and some buffers and latches to separate out the address signals and the data bus signals. So just lay out the board, we're going to put the address decode down the bottom, but we probably need to move the CPU up a couple of lines. Also get the data lines to come out parallel and remove the resistors. Okay, so just going to move all the power rails and the tie to ground and 5 volts up. The resistors that we want to keep have moved up and take the no operation resistors out for the moment. We just move the chip up two strips, shorten the leads coming down from the clock circuit by two strips as well so they fit better. We're going to clip the boards together. Then we need to replace the breadboard buddy at the top with a two-board breadboard buddy. Then I'm just putting in each of the chips and checking that the chip label is the right way around. All of the chips on the left here have got pin one facing downwards, which is not the traditional way, but the pin layout works better that way. So just going to make up some wires to fit to the board, and we'll also take the Duhamel cables and connect a number of the loose leads into crimp housings. Okay, so we're just going to put in the power rails for each of the chips. Now the one at the top there is going to need a wire coming round to the left hand side because we've got our power distribution clip in there. I'm just going to put the decoupling capacitors in against each of the chips close to the ground rail. Then we're just putting in the data bus going from AD0 to AD7 on the processor over to the bidirectional buffer. Just check what we need to wire up next. So now we're just wiring in the S0 to S2 from the CPU, the clock signal, the direction, and the address latch enable. So now we're doing some of the output enable tied to ground for the moment. When we introduce DMA, we're going to need to add these to the board to go from the DMA logic. Just making up some extra three-way and four-way leads there. Plugging in the connectors for the address lines. So now we've been able to separate the address and data bus signals, and we've also generating all the control signals that we need. What we need to do now is to add an address decoder, and this provides the chip enable signals for the ROM and the RAM that we're going to be adding. We're actually going to be using EEPROM, so that's electrically erasable programmable read-only memory, and then we'll also be adding a 512k random access memory as well. We'll then run a test program to verify that we can read and write to the RAM and ROM. So this is the PLD configuration file, which we're going to compile using WinCUPL. This produces a JED file, which then we can use to program the ATF22V10 PLD. Once this is programmed, we can also test this. The test feature allows us to highlight errors in red. So we'll just change something to make a deliberate error here, and it will come up in red when we test it. See, we can say that red, we change it back. So I'm just going to fit that now to the board, and we're going to use the bus rails for the address and data bus. So take out the PLD out of the programmer, we're just removing all the logic analyzer signals. Now we're just going to replace the inverter with the PLD here, wiring the power, put in the reset lines, and the data enable just going in there, then the memory read, memory write. We also just need to do the clock. Okay, so I needed to add some pins to zero insertion for socket. I also removed the tabs off of the bus bar and also put some power connectors. Okay, so just snap the chips in there. There's enough space to get the address and data lines around there. So just going to wire in the power. Once you've done the power, we'll just put in the decoupling capacitors. Now we're going to wire in the data bus, then wire in the A0 to A7 and A8 to A15, and then finally the top four address lines. Just check those off. Now we're just going to wire these two chips, the address lines on these two chips together, because they share a lot of them in common. Now we're just going to wire in all the data lines for the two chips. There's five data lines on the bottom and there's three on the top. We need to come down to the bottom of the board there. Now we need to get the control signals, so we need to take the memory read and memory write signals round from the input to the PLD and put them onto the bus there, and then we'll take the reset and the E signals. We'll be needing those in later videos for plugging in the keyboard and serial port. Okay, so check those off. So now we're going to do the chip enables, write enables, and output enables. So the write enable going in there, the output enable, the ROM chip enable, and the chip enable for the RAM is going to come from the A19 signal. So now we're wiring in all the address lines for the RAM on the left-hand side here. And once we've done the ones coming from the bottom side of the RAM chip up to the bus there, we're then going to wire in a lot of those lines then going to come across to the bottom of the EEPROM on the right there. So we avoid having to put these cables going up onto the bus area. Fortunately, all these chips have very similar address pin layouts. And then this is the chip enable going to A19, then you're just wiring across the shared address lines there. Okay, so check those off. So now we've added the ROM and the RAM and we've tested that. What we need to do now is to add the peripheral interface adapter, and this is a parallel port that allows us to then talk to the 7-segment LED display and also the 25-key keypad. So just laid out the chips and put a power rail breadboard buddy in. Okay, so just going to put in the power lines for each of the chips and a decoupling capacitor for each of the chips as well on the close to the ground line. Then the feed from the rest of the computer for the power bus as well. Now we're going to put in the data bus lines for the peripheral interface adapter. Once we've done that, we'll put in the address A0 and A1 lines and the reset. And then we'll do the E-clock signal, the chip select tied high, and the chip select coming from the PIA enable on the PLD. Check all those off. Now we're going to put the outputs from port B to go into the decoder. The PLD first, then the BCD decoder. Now this is the output from port A going into the Darlington driver for driving the 7-segment display. Check all those off. I'm just putting the power there. I did also put in a cable there in yellow for Q7. We're also putting P0 to P3. Check all those off. Now this is 7-segment display. Just going to plug that in as a block of 8 for all of the digit display things and the 7-segment display. Check all off. Now we're going to plug in the keypad, and that goes to the Q0 to Q3 and the PA outputs. So we've got the 8-digit display now, and we also forgot to add the pull-up resistors. Okay, so we need to assemble the test program, burn it into the EEPROM, and then we're going to test the keypad and the 7-segment display. So the display seems to be working with our test patterns. Now we're testing all of the key codes to make sure they're all as expected. Okay, so now we've wired up the peripheral interface adapter and we've tested the 7-segment LED display and the keypad. So what we need to do now is to convert the original Nanocomp 6809 monitor software into 8088 assembler. And so we're just going to assemble that and burn that into the EEPROM, and then we'll test that the monitor's working. Okay, so we copied and pasted the 6809 code on the right-hand side there, then converted it in line, and then we're just going to assemble this. Now we're going to program the EEPROM. You can see that's now coming up as Nanocomp 8088 version 1. These are the commands we're going to be testing. So test the memory inspect and change, then type go, and the register display. So now we've tested that the monitor is working, all we're going to do now is to add a serial port, and we're going to use a USB serial converter to talk to the PC. So just going to move the keypad over onto the right-hand side, just lay things out. Probably need to straighten the pins there on the USB converter there. So I straighten the pins on the serial adapter. We just put on the label. I'm just going to put in the power leads and the decoupling capacitors, needed one there, ground for the USB connector. So this is putting in the E and the read-write signals and A0. Register select the chip enable highs and the chip enable low to the output of the decoder. We just need to do the receive, transmit and clear to send, request to send. And then the clear to send, to request to send, and the clock. Now we need to do the data lines and just move the cables so they're out of the way of the chip labels. So we've updated the monitor to version 2 and assembled that and updated it. We've also got a test program in S record format. Now we're going to plug in the PC. We've got version 2 of the monitor there. Now we're going to test a simple file. We should get F. Yep, complete. Now we're going to send our sample program and check the memory. F9 at the end, that's correct. Then we've got an error, checksum error and a hex error. So we've got the error handling is correct. And then we're just going to save the program back up onto the PC and check the byte values, which appear to be the same. So that completes the NanoComp 8088 version. If you're interested in seeing a summary of the NanoComp 6809, there'll be a link in the top right corner of the screen here and also down in the description below the video. In the next series of videos, I'm going to be building out a monochrome display adapter compatible video controller. We'll then be adding the PS2 keyboard controller and all the other PC-specific hardware down below until we're able to get a BIOS installed and working, which will then hopefully allow us to boot MS-DOS from floppy disk. And then later on, we'll be adding an IDE disk controller, CGA video controller, and then hopefully trying to run an early version of Windows. So if you don't want to miss out on the future videos, please hit subscribe. And if you found the content interesting, please hit like. It just helps to make the videos available to a wider number of people. Thanks for watching.